Thank you very much, and thank you so much, Dylan and Maria. It's a real pleasure for me to be here. As Ralph was saying before, it's actually a privilege to be part of the very first TEDx, so thank you all for having this. Alzheimer's disease, what am I gonna do about it? Let's start this way. Picture a person, okay? Picture a person who can't remember recent events. A person, in fact, who can't even walk, can't eat, can't dress himself, overall confined to bed in a fetal position, totally helpless. So maybe this was the person you were imagining? No, maybe not. But this person here can't do these things because of an absence of neural circuits. So this person is growing his brain or her brain in order to make these functions happen. Now what happens after all these beautiful circuits have been created? As you get old, Alzheimer's disease starts to make those circuits unravel. This is an image, a photograph of the very first Alzheimer's patient. Her name was Augusta D. This language down here is incontinent, screaming terribly, etc. Those are actually Alzheimer's words himself as he was taking care of Augusta D. He was a neurologist and met her regularly. In one of his sessions with her, he asked her to pick up a pen and write her name down, and she couldn't do it. What she said instead was, "I've lost myself." And actually, I heard my mother-in-law say exactly the same words as she was going through Alzheimer's disease. Now, we can appreciate intellectually what Alzheimer's disease must be like, but what I like about this series of self-portraits from William Untermalen is he shows us what it's like inside, what it feels like to have Alzheimer's disease. He had Alzheimer's disease. He was a portrait artist. His wife said, "Keep painting." And as you can see, as the disease progressed, he lost more and more of himself. Alzheimer's, it's a progressive disease. It begins with memory loss, a serious memory loss, and it's ultimately fatal. Part of the progression is the fact that changes in the brain, the dysfunctional aspects of the brain, the pathology in the brain, actually begins decades before dementia, which is something we all need to be concerned about, even when we're relatively young. I mean, when you're relatively young. 1 in 8 persons over 65 has Alzheimer's disease. How early can it begin? The earliest that we know is a pair of Polish brothers who had Alzheimer's disease in their 20s. Very rare, due to a mutation. Matter of fact, there are some types of Alzheimer's disease that are inherited. This is usually early onset Alzheimer's disease, but as I said, it's very rare. It's very rare, but the sporadic form of Alzheimer's disease is very common, and it's very costly. It's the third most costly of all diseases. It's costing our economy over $200 billion a year. And unfortunately, the diagnosis of Alzheimer's is imprecise, and even worse, the therapeutics are basically worthless. So you have to ask yourself, what would you do? And if you were paying attention to Ravi's talk like I was, which was a fantastic talk, he said, what you want to do is look and see what's going bad. And that's exactly what Alzheimer did in 1906. So not only was he treating Augusta D, he was a scientist as well. She died in her early 50s. When she died, he did an autopsy on her brain, applied state-of-the-art technology, and he was able to see changes in her brain that hadn't been noticed before. So what you see here is a piece of human brain tissue, not Augusta D's, but more modern. And in the center, there's something labeled A. That's an amyloid plaque. It's a characteristic of Alzheimer's disease. And we can see it because it's stained with a protein stain. And these are individual neurons. This one is diseased. These over here, they're perfectly normal. So these are pathologies that Alzheimer discovered in the brain of Augusta D. The amazing thing is nothing happened for 5 or 6 decades afterwards. Early pathology detected in the 1970s. It took until the 1970s before people made the next really exciting discovery. And that is an important neurotransmitter called acetylcholine is drastically lowered in the brains of Alzheimer's disease. What difference does that make? Well, experiments that were also going on in the 1970s in learning and memory laboratories, found that if you take a drug and block the action of acetylcholine in a region of the brain called the hippocampus, learning is blocked. Basically, you have amnesia. So when there's acetylcholine functioning badly, there's a failure of learning. So what do? Try to restore acetylcholine in the brains of people who have Alzheimer's disease. And in fact, the way to target it was to go after an enzyme that breaks down acetylcholine. It's called acetylcholinesterase. And the very first drugs to treat, to be used to treat Alzheimer's disease were those that were capable of inhibiting the breakdown of acetylcholine. And you probably may or may not know, but this was extraordinarily lucrative. One of the drugs, Aricept, was bringing into its company, Eisai, $3 billion a year. And the problem is, it didn't really work. It worked for a little while, and then the effects disappeared, and people continued to develop the same progressive loss of cognitive function. The problem was, it wasn't disease-modifying. Acetylcholine is made at synapses in the brain, and it's used at synapses in the brain. But in the brain, as you can see from these images here, the synapses and where they're located deteriorate with dementia. This is a normal-looking neuron from a human brain. This is one that's deteriorated, and here's one that's totally damaged. And what we see is this is the type of neuron that appears in a normal elderly person. This is the type of neuron that appears in somebody with dementia. So again, what to do? What to do? What we want to do is discover the cause of that loss and then deal with it. Well, it turns out that there are a number of diseases, Alzheimer's being one of them, in which good proteins go bad. Mad cow disease, type 2 diabetes, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease with its plaques and tangles. All of those plaques and the tangles in Alzheimer's disease, well, they're made of a very specific protein, different proteins in these other diseases. And when you look at what those proteins do, they stick to each other and develop these fibrils that are called amyloid. The major focus in Alzheimer's disease for over 20 years has been amyloid that's derived from a normal peptide in the brain. That normal peptide is called A-beta. This little cartoon here says, look, here's a protein that's found in the membrane of a nerve cell, all these beta, alpha, gamma, epsilon. Those are enzymes that break up that protein, part of normal metabolism. And through that complicated normal metabolism, you end up with a small peptide, only 42 amino acids long, called A-beta, that's normal. You're all making A-beta a lot in your brains. I'm making it too. You're clearing it out very well. I'm probably clearing it out not so well. If you could see this a little better, this is an image showing individual molecules of A-beta by an atomic force microscope. If that A-beta is allowed to be in solution with itself for a day even, at a high concentration, this is what happens. It converts into these very gnarly looking ugly fibrils. Those fibrils are toxic. And these types of observations gave rise to an important hypothesis called the amyloid cascade hypothesis. Dominated the field for a long time. This is a human nerve cell in a culture dish. This is some amyloid that we synthesized, and you can see that they interact with each other here. So A-beta solutions in a test tube, they slowly form neurotoxins. What those toxic solutions contain are these large fibrils of amyloid. Actually, those types of amyloid that you see in a test tube are almost identical to what you see in the brain of somebody who has Alzheimer's disease. Importantly, human genetics showed that people who had inherited forms of Alzheimer's disease, the mutations that were related to that and caused it, all linked back to the A-beta peptide. It caused A-beta to go up. So that gave rise to the amyloid cascade hypothesis. It said very simply, elegantly, Alzheimer's disease is nerve cell death caused by deposits like these of amyloid fibrils. Now you have a target And you again ask yourself, what to do? Well, you'd like to be able to clear out that stuff from the brain. And there was a very brilliant idea that came out of a group in San Francisco, headed by Dale Shank, who developed a vaccine. So he had an antibody and a vaccine that could clear away this amyloid in mouse models of Alzheimer's disease. This was in 1999. This has gone to the clinic now. And the results have just started to come out strongly over the last couple of years. They failed. So Pfizer and Johnson had a vaccine that they developed to clear out amyloid plaques, and the consequences were basically nil. Why is that? Really, it's the wrong target. And we try, but sometimes we don't hit the right target. But the beauty of science is good ideas ultimately, eventually, beat bad ones. For example, in 350 BC, it was known to the Greeks that mind resides in the liver, which is a perfectly sensible idea. And actually, only after only 2,000 years, it became clear to science that maybe it's in the brain and not in the liver. Well, we've just heard that the acetylcholine hypothesis really didn't work too well. Amyloid plaque vaccines are inadequate. So what are we looking at these days? Today, it looks like the toxin that accumulates in the brains of Alzheimer's people is related to plaques, but different. It's an A-beta oligomer, not an A-beta amyloid fibril. This is some work that was discovered by our team a number of years ago. What we found was that fibrils really aren't the only toxins made by A-beta. These are the fibrils that I showed you before, but instead, what we discovered, if you start with the very same A-beta peptide in a test tube, if you adjust the conditions in one way, you get fibrils. If you adjust the conditions just a little bit, you get these small dots, which turn out to be oligomers of A-beta rather than fibrils. And this is work that came from my lab in collaboration with Grant Kraft and Tuck Finch at USC. And we were so excited about this finding that ultimately we ended up starting a company called Acumen, which I'll mention again in a bit. So structurally, those are very interesting molecules. But even more interestingly is what they do. So what you're looking at here is a nerve cell in a dish, a piece of a nerve cell. And these little protrusions, this is a dendrite here, these little protrusions are parts of a synapse. They're called synaptic spines. And this is what the spines look like normally, shortly after exposure to addles. We call these addles, these A-beta oligomers that they're toxic. We call them addles. However, once those synapses have been exposed to addles for 3 hours, the morphology is completely different. Now they're long, thin, lollipop-like structures with a little bead on the top. Clearly a strong morphological pathology being induced by them. Is that significant? Well, here's an example. These are human images from human brain, stained where the dendrite is stained with a particular tool, and you see these short, stubby spines of the synapses, just like what we see here. And in individuals who had died and had mental retardation, Fragile X syndrome, the spines, the synapses, are totally morphologically altered, just like what we see with the addles. So the notion is that this is, in fact, very neurologically significant. And there's a raft of data suggesting that's the case. And that has led the NIH to put out this diagram in which damaged neurons in Alzheimer's disease, that damage that leads to dementia, is attributed to the toxic action of oligomers acting at these little spots on the surface. Amyloid fibril plaques, they're off to the side, no longer center stage in understanding the cause of the disease. If we drill down just a bit to see why these addles might be neurotoxins, can we go back to putting nerve cells in a dish and expose them to synthetic addles? We can make them in a test tube, and we add them to the cells in a dish. And what we find is that they appear at little tiny spots along the dendrites. Those are at synapses. What they do when they're there is cause a change in the organization and molecular composition of that synapse, leading to memory loss. Quick reality check. Do these have anything to do with what's going on in the brain? Well, we take that same antibody and find that we can detect these A-beta oligomers, these addles, in human brains very early in the Alzheimer's disease process, before plaques and tangles. A couple last slides here. What I've been talking about is basic research, but what we want to do is go from the bench to the bedside. And what we've been doing is taking those same antibodies that we developed to detect A-beta oligomers and make an MRI probe on them. So these are results that we just obtained over the last couple of months. We have a mouse model, and we have one that has Alzheimer's disease, one that doesn't. We give it the probe, and what we can find is the mouse that has Alzheimer's disease gives us a signal. The mouse that doesn't have any Alzheimer's disease does not. So we think we're going to be able to approach Alzheimer's diagnostics by looking for oligomers in the brain by brain imaging. And we can also use it for therapeutics. The company I mentioned before, Acumen, has developed an antibody in collaboration with Merck that has therapeutic potential. So we expect to be able to deliver this to people, and it will stop the progression of Alzheimer's disease. The problem is, most drugs fail. Investigational new drugs don't make it. So what we need is more research to come up with better diagnostics and better therapeutics. Fortunately, there's an investment from the federal government in research into Alzheimer's disease. In fact, it's $500 million a year. And that's enough money to buy every man, woman, and child in this country a cup of coffee. So maybe if you looked at it slightly differently, research amounts to this much per year, the cost of care amounts to that. So the ratio is about 400 to 1. Could be a good idea to invest more in Alzheimer's disease. By the way, 40 years from now, when you're going to be seriously worried about it, this is going to be $1 trillion a year, which is about what all of the military costs of the world are today. So what are we going to do while we're waiting? Take your mom's advice. What she said was, get plenty of exercise and eat right. That works for Alzheimer's disease. Basically, if it's good for your heart, it's good for your brain. And in fact, since you're thinking about these things as finals come up, keep studying. Mental workouts really couldn't hurt. Let me finish by saying there are three thank yous I want to give. First of all, to my lab, who's been working on this problem for 15 years, and support from all sorts of different institutions that help make this happen. And once again, to you and your organizers for having this wonderful session today. So thank you.